Ladies and gentlemen, I am very pleased to be here with you for a second time as guest speaker in the series of lectures held by the Turkish Cultural Foundation. We will speak, my topic is the Karamanlar, the people who read books, periodicals, newspapers in the Turkish language, printed in Greek characters. Today, I have chosen to speak to you about the image of the Turkish-speaking Anatolian Christian in 19th century theater. We shall look at the key elements of this theatrical persona through at least three plays. We shall essentially see from theatrical viewpoint the picture that Greek and Ottoman societies in Smyrna and Istanbul presented of the 19th century Turkish-speaking Christian in the Ottoman Empire. I shall begin with Babylonia, the first modern Greek play. Its full title is Babylonia, or the Corruption of the Greek Language in Various Places. It was composed by the Istanbulu dramatist Dimitrios Vizandios, a nom de plume. His real name was Dimitrios Aslanis, son of Hagi Konstantin. It was first published in 1836. The story revolves around a basic myth, which is used as a pretext, but also as an opportunity to reveal the characters and dialect of the various types of the Hellenism, represented on stage, the relationships and the contrast between them. It is the story of Greeks from different parts of Greece who are celebrating the victory of the Allied forces at the Battle of Navarino in 1827. The play is set in an inn, in a locanda, in Nafplion. Nafplion is in Mora, in Peloponnesus. The iconographer Dimitrios Vizandios, because this was the real profession of this dramatist, because never you can have some money from the art or from as an author. Okay, presents in a comical manner the misunderstandings between the characters resulting from each one's local dialect and language. The persons of the play. First of all, Kaiserly Hagi Savas, son of Hagi Muradis, the name of my grandfather. The moral play. Two men, of Chios, Sakizada Sindan. According to the Greek saying, Hiotes Sakisla travel two by two. The Cretan, the Arnavut, the Cypriot, the scholar, and the Eptanesian policeman and the secretary take part in the play, which, while some other secondary characters have secondary roles. The plot is as follows. During the celebrations, the Arnavut shoots the Cretan. The cause of this was the word kuradi, which in Cretan means ship, kuzu. While in Greek, kusurabakmein, it means shit, excrement. And this made the Arnaut mad with rage as he thought he was being insulted. Everyone is arrested, apart from the Arnavut. Arnavut who flees, and they are interrogated by the Ptanisian policemen. The prisoners find it impossible to understand the dialect of Ptanisian policemen because his dialect was plenty of Italian words, while the policeman cannot understand the dialects of those involved. And the result was everybody, they all be thrown into jail. Finally, following a document from the governor, for the issue of which our Caramel intercepted, the prisoners are set free. Let's take a look at how Byzantios describes the Anatolian type, which he favors as he's very familiar with it due to their common origin. He is presented as being a native of Kayseri, of course, and it is dressed accordingly in a tsuba, and turban and ankled length breeches. Byzantios wants him to be independent of any European influences. Kayseri Hagisavas is not poor, but a wealthy commoner who knows how to eat, how to drink, how to be merry. Byzantios presents him as illiterate, but as the cleverest of the group. He is the only one to realize that the Lokantadze has cheated them on the bill. Yet he does not pick a quarrel with him, but neither does he sign the debit note when the Lokantadze asks him to do so. Whatever you write in the prison doesn't count, he responds to his demands. The Anatolian also knows how to handle the authority, such as a police chief. He essentially knows how to survive and to find solutions to difficult situations. His wisdom is that of the common man. At the festivities, he is reserved. For example, he didn't like the manners of the drunk Sakazil. He is the only one to foresee the Arnavut's attack just before it happens. In prison, he also plays a central role, taking the initiative for their release. He shows compassion to the poor scholar, pays his share of the debt to the Lokanda, and in addition, to help him financially himself, although he was illiterate, he buys his books, and orders for him an epigram for his father tombstone. A real sponsor, isn't it?
Yes.
The highly amusing character Hagisava, son of Hagimuratis from Kayseri, was to set his seal, fairly or unfairly, on all the subsequent iconography of Anatolians and Caramanlar in modern Greek literature. The work clearly also captures what Cappadocia represented in the collective memory of Hellenism in the early 19th century. The channel that conserved in the collective memory this otherwise unknown region were the hagiographic myths. In a scene in Babylonia, the policemen finally realized what Kaiserli, where Kaiserli Hadzisavas came from, only when the latter tells him it's the place of Saint Basil, Kayseri of Cappadocia, don't you know? And when the arranged policeman, who does not understand what the Caramanlı is saying, calls him Yaourtovaftismeno, baptized in yaourt, and Paliotourka, dirty Turk. And the Anatolian answers, I am not a Turk, I am Christian Orthodox and a Hadji. The characterization Yaourtovaftismenos, baptized in yaourt, will be heard 100 years later, when the Turkish speaking refugees from Anatolia comes to Greek, following the exchange of populations. The local Greeks call them Yaourtovaftismenos, indirectly discrediting their Greek origin. The fact that Istanbul, Dimitrios Byzantios, included Karamanlidika, in reality Turkish and corrupted Greek, in this place, along with Arnautsa, Albanian and corrupted Greek, and some other dialects of this newly founded Greek state, means that all these dialects coexisted on equal footing with the Greek language. Ultimately, which Greek language we are talking about? The new state, the Greek state, adopted the Peloponnesian dialect as the official Greek language. In the case of Byzantios Babylonia, although we have a language comedy, in actual fact, it is a social comedy. Its social aspects comprise a handbook of Greece at that time. Although the conflicts in the play are not based on an ideology, but it is obvious that languages, and we have a specialist on this subject, Mehmet, convey ideological constructs. The play also was extremely successful and was very popular among the public, both in Greece and in Istanbul. It was, we have at least 28 times, as I find according to the programs, in Istanbul during the period 1863-1881. That means in 30 years we have approximately 30 plays. And we have many, many editions of this book. Let's look at a few video clips I have chosen for the occasion from the play that was into a film when I was in Lycée, that means in 1970.
Aferin. Aferin işe başta. Siz diye deyen ses. İnde epiginiden. Başlarıma kayışerli diyor. Eki. Eki nasıl çıkar onu çarptın bir ofinden. Ama ve avgat ya. Nasıl son gamon gata poston tetenen. Ver ufaya. Nasıl son gamon me avgan. Romidim boyniko beberiye beberiye bakariye. Εσύ ξέρεις όλους. Ε, ναι, σας να σας χαρών. Και κρομίδιν πάνω σας. Και πεπέριν μπόλικον. Να εφανθεί η καρδία σας. Ο θέλει μη σε βαστά. Τι ήταν αυτό που είπα τα βουρτούλα που με έβρε. Τα Ιάντα Τσάνα τίποτα δεν είναι. Έρισου λιγάκι. Γύρτικο είπε κουράδι. Αρναούτι είπε, να φας εσύ. Κουράδια μουράδια λέοντας και καυγαλαδίζοντας. Αρναούτι τράβηξε η πιστόλη του, κυρτικό κομμάτι χέρι για ραλάτις. Έχει αυτό. Να με πάρουνε χείλες για όλους και δεν κατάλαβα τίποτσι. Φύγε, μωρέ, Ρουμέικα. Ήτανε κάζο πενσατό.
Μισάτο, εγώ δεν ξέρω φυράγγικα.
Πες μου σωστά την εζαμινά σου, γιατί και κόρη και θα πασαρέστω.
Στη Ρωμαϊκά το είπα. Αρναούτι χτύπησε γυρτικό. Άρτε και τώρα δεν κατάλαβες.
Πώς έτσι δεν τα κατάλαβες. Αρέστο, κανάλια! Αρέστο, αρέστο!
Εγώ τι έκανα, τζάρμι, να πάω αρέστο. Εγώ δεν χτύπησα γυρτικό. Ποιος αρναούτι, κρέμες το πήρε.
Όχι, τα πάω εγώ, αρέστο. Αρέστο, γιαγούρτο βαφτισμένε, παλιό Τουρκά.
Εγώ Τούρκο δεν είμαι. Χριστιανό ορθόδοξο είμαι. Ότι άνθρωπο είμαι. Οι ψέματα ποτέ μου δεν λέω. Ότι άνθρωπο είμαι. Οι ψέματα ποτέ μου δεν λέω.
The second comedy, this time with the Karamanli in the leading role, is set in Smyrna. It was published in 1845 and bears the title in English, the Sevdali Haji Aslani's Hero of Karaman. It is a comedy in five parts, composed by Evangelinos Misailidis, a very well-known person because he was the publisher of a newspaper, Karaman newspaper, Anatolu, and he published also more than 100 books, Karaman Ledger. He signs this book with his initials. Anonymity provided a shield mainly against the reactions of the members of the community to which he belonged. Other playwrights of the era also used of the same tactic. These biting satires forced their writers to hide behind initials. It is obvious from the title that Misailidis was inspired by Byzantios Babylonia. It is no coincidence that the leading actor bears the real name of the author of Babylonia. He is named Haji Aslanis. No copy of the first edition of the comedy, published in 1945, has survived. The only copy through the second edition from 1972, which circulated in Smyrna without the permission of the publisher Misailidis, was discovered in the British Library. No other copy has been found until now, and probably never will be, as the circulation of the second edition was forbidden, mainly because of its provocative and indecent content, Mugairi Edep, as stated in an Ottoman document from the censorship. The events around the discovery and the publishing adventure of the second comedy were a little bit like a Sherlock Holmes story, and were the subject of a study published in Turkish. I published it in Toplum Sal Tarih 3 years before, in August 2009. I am giving the bibliographic reference for anyone who wishes quick access, as it contains experts from the actors' dialogues very skillfully translated by Ari Chokona. The reading public evidently welcomed enthusiastically the play's publication, since its sales reached such a volume that Evangelinos Misailidis was able to re-establish his destroyed printing house during an earthquake of Smyrna. Let us now return to the censorship of the work. As already mentioned, we lack any explanation of the reasons. Therefore, we can only speculate on the matter. One wonders whether the committee members consider the work indecent because of its bold subject, a rich, old, uncouth Karamanlı, Hagi Aslanis, who is madly in love with the younger servant, Marula. One wonders either whether that was deemed provocative was the plot cooked up by the secondary characters who rob and ridicule him, but all go unpunished in the end. After all, from the very beginning, the play unfolds as a collective plot to rob the wealthy Karamanlı Hagi Aslanis. Many different individuals participate in this conspiracy. The shoemaker, Frontinos from the Cyclad, Larezos, and his wife Irini, who are Marula's parents, the matchmaker and war mistress Marukaki from Sakız, the learned Leonidas or Leronidas from Aivalon, secretary to Hagi Aslanis, who uses rusty bookish Greek, ancient Greek. Master craftsman Manolelis from Mytilene with his stratelis, his metzi. And Marula's lover, Captain Gerasimos from Kefalonia. All these characters are representative of the Greek-speaking society of Smyrna, whose dialectical variety at the same time maps its speaker's origins. For me, it is not accidental that Missailides, the author, presents precisely these characters as the conspirators against their wealthy, follow Orthodox Christian, the Karamanlı Hagisavas. This Greek-speaking world is contrasted with another world in an Ottoman Empire, that of the Turkish-speaking. The iconography of the Turkish Gairi Muslim side by side with their colingual Hagi Aslanis is complemented by other funny characters, the Armenian Hambarchun and his wife Meryem, in whose house Marula works as a servant. Ham Solomon, Hagi Aslanis' Jewish agent, and his wife Ruhala, as well as the rabbi of the synagogue. Each one of them speaks his or her own version of Turkish, stamped by the accent of his or her millet, and each presents two other non-Muslim millets of the Ottoman Empire, the Armenian and the Jewish. The end of the play is marked by the intervention of the authorities, represented by the characters of the Muslim corporal and his soldiers, who escort the native, robbed and abandoned Karamanlı in the lunative asylum, while Hagi Aslanis is lamenting his love for the unfaithful and heartless Marula. The play also satirizes, among other things, the prevailing promiscuity in Smyrna and this kind of marriage that were based on the sight of the dowry. Characteristic of such satire are Hagi Aslanis' remarks as the follow. Anatolians immediately strive to marry high-class girls, and the Smyrniotes search for large dowries, and they do not examine whether she has been poked and kissed. I, on the other hand, go for one to like, even if she is poor, but she has to be honorable and homemaker. Likewise, his comments to the matchmaker Marukaki from Chios show that he is fully aware from the customs of young couples in love in Smyrna. You are fully aware that here in Smyrna, young people get engaged, talk it out freely with their sweetheart, and sometimes they take them to Kemer or to Slaburunu or to some orchards, and nobody says anything about it. Would you could do the same in our vilayet? They place you backwards on a donkey, and they carry you all over your hometown, and the lover does not see his sweetheart, because she is, if he sees her, then it is over. He leaves because he is a great shame for him to stay behind. The play, perhaps, was considered immoral because it presents such new wave of amorous behavior. Likewise, one needs to consider the fact that the play is full of swearing, sometimes very grave. Many a time, while speaking to his secretary, Haji Aslanis, used the word ulan, boko, boko glu bok, etc., topelu topek, etc. And he is not the only one, since others are equally adept at using bad language, even the rabbi. The latter not only beats Haji Aslanis, but also attacks him verbally when the Karamanlou makes fun of him concerning the time of prayer in the synagogue. It is worth noting that Misailidis sets up a number of conflict scenes involving Jews. During these scenes, an Orthodox Christian and a Jew exchange swear words that are not only full of sight, but only delineate ideological stance against one other. For Haji Aslanis, Ham Solomon is nothing but a miskin chifit, an esek chifit, who should to be obligated to speak Greek, which draws the retort, and you, why don't you speak Greek? Both comedies base their theme on linguistic pluralism. In Babylonia, the heroes are Orthodox Christians, and the language they speak, despite their dialectical differences, is Greek. In the second comedy, the comic element is again based on heteroglossia of the heroes, who are also of different religions. Orthodox, Armenians, Jews, Muslims. They speak Greek, Greek dialects, ancient Greek, archaic Greek, Jewish, Armenian, Turkish. The Sevdali Haji Aslanis represents the linguistic reality of the Ottoman Empire and the variety and the multiplicity not only of Greek as spoken by the Greek-speaking characters in the comedy, but also of Turkish as spoken by the Karamanli Haji Aslanis, the Armenian Ham Barzun, and his Jews Ham Solomon and the Rabbi. In addition, though of the verbal and other confrontations, the comedy portrays the relations between the Gairi Muslim millets in the empire, which one could say were anything but decent. The rich Anatolian, our Karamanli, who falls in love and seeks marriage with the much younger Marula, is soured by the other rooms came from islands, from Ionian islands, as we see, Cyclades, Chios, Mytilene. With derogatory adjectives. Χατζή τσουράπ, δύο γράμματα. Παστούρματζε, etc. Which are linked on his Ottoman style apparel and eating habits. They also call him sorcery, as he is unsophisticated, even crude, in relation to other rooms, to whom he is just an idiot. Yet, they also use the adjective sardelovaftismenos, that means baptized in sardine juice, which obviously hints at his ethno-religious integration. All this reflects the cliché of the Western or oriented Smyrniot room society that treats an uncouth Anatolian with contempt. By straying from the traditional context of his life and striving to access another of his desire to follow the new morals of Smyrna, Evangelinos Misailidis Karamanl Hadzi Aslanis comes to a tragic end. He is robbed by Maroulas companions, ridiculed, psychological crushed by the despicable persons who in the end and even go unpunished in modern era Smyrna. In the third comedy, entitled Malakoff, by Gine de Istanbulou Mikhail Hurmuzis, the Anatolian character is an Armenian woman. Now we don't have a Karamanlı, we have an Armenian Turkish-speaking woman, a servant. Her name was Fedai, who is, in her broken Greek, mixed with many Turkish words and phrases, attempts to restrain her mistress, Smaragda, and her daughter, Katingo, from extravagant finery. A comedy published in 1965, influenced by the didactism of Molière, Molière's comedy, and Goldoni's, in which Hurmuzis presents the disorientation of the Istanbul bourgeoisie and the imitation of the Western manners and customs. It focuses on the phenomenon of Western fashion, on which enormous sums of money are spent bringing great wealth to the clever dressmaker Teresina Baknes. This is something Teresina, the name of the dressmaker, who takes advantage of the situations, acquires a large amount of real estate in Galata. The name of the comedy bears witness to this. Malakoff is the round, voluminous petticoat that took its name from the Malakoff fortress in Sevastopol, around which deadly battles took place during the Crimean War. It satirizes the flashy consumer frenzy of the Istanbul Nouveau Riche, as well as other similar ones. The plot of the play is as follows. Do you have the courage to listen to me, eh? Okay. Pavlakis, husband of Smaragda and father of Aleko and Katingo, resident of Fana, is spending the summer in Buyukada. A tradesman who made a fortune during the war. His household also includes the cook Danili, the servant Fruru, and the old Armenian woman Fedai. While he himself is aware of the provisionality of wealth accumulation, the members of his family spend money lavishly or and his wife friend Dudu and her daughter Ralu kindly smaragdla a katingos appetite for consumption and flamboyancy. His son Aleko also lives a luxury life with visits in casino, etc. The dressmaker Teresina, Kazamias and Zafiris are the ones who profit from this squandering. Pavlakis benefits the church and the Rum community of Bouyoukada. He himself is frugal and conservative person. He mocks his family members for foolishly imitating European trends. But when he learns that his friend Stefanaki was ruined by his family's similar imprudence, he realizes that his own household is at risk of similar ruin and decided to lay down the law. He tears his wife's dresses to shreds, demands obedience, and forces his son into employment. The Anatolian Fedai present in most parts of the play adds a touch of logic to the absurdities taking place with the ordering of dresses, hats, corsets, etc., that are draining her master Pavlakis of his fortune. It is she who, through her references to her aunts, becomes the guardian of the old demure customs and manners of the female sex. Fedai provides details of the traditional attire, of grooming methods, ridiculing European dances, flamboyant hats, voluminous silk dresses, and the libertine behavior of young girls. She speaks of food, practical medicine, her words describing the everyday life of a Rum or Armenian house in Istanbul. She cares about her master and has the conciliatory role in the troubled life of the family, attempting to calm the stormy relations between its members. Her Anatolian, interspersed with Turkish words and phrases, which Hurmuzis annotates in the theatrical edition, comes into contrast with France that is invading the bourgeoisie Rum community in Istanbul. Through the Turkish-speaking Armenian Fedai, Hurmuzis advocates austerity and at all levels of life and the preservation of the traditions which he sees as being threatened by the invasion of the Western modernisms. Here we presented three different types of Turkish-speaking Anatolians, who are the central heroes of three popular comedies from the first half of the 19th century. Turkophony, the Anatolians eating, the clothing habits are ridiculed as they presented cultural retardation for urban residents as in the Ottoman Empire, as in Istanbul and Smyrna. Having themselves adopting Western cultural models. The simplicity of the Karamanlar, the Armenian Christians, their devotion to religion and tradition, the spirit of economy, the avarice they possess, the solidary conservative life they choose to lead, makes them stand out from the room bourgeoisie of Istanbul and Smyrna. And until recently, Turkish occupied Greek territory, as we see in Babylonia. They live in different worlds. And these Turkish speaking Orthodox people will have the experience this first hand in Greece, where they will find themselves after the exchange of population. I hope that I could give you an example of a project that is in the pipeline. And I will be very happy if some younger will continue to search in this field. It is an excellent field for history and literature. Thank you very much.
Thank you.